Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Leslie Oliver, and I'm the EDI specialist with the Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. Welcome to our first session in the Black History Month speaker series. Before we begin, I would like to make you aware of some resources available to attendees. The closed captions have been enabled. You can access the captions by hitting the CC button in your control bar. The chat function has been disabled for this event. If you have a question, please submit it in the Q&A tab in your control options, and we will review them at the end. We will begin with a land acknowledgement offered by Janique Wilson.
We acknowledge that Western University is located on the traditional lands of the Anishinaabeg, Haudenosaunee, Lenapawak, and Chonantan Nations, on lands connected with the London Township and Somber Treaties of 1796 and the Dish With One Spoon Covenant Wampum. With this, we respect the long-standing relationships that Indigenous nations have to this land, as they are the original caretakers. We acknowledge historical and ongoing injustices that Indigenous peoples endure in Canada, and we accept the responsibility as a public institution to contribute toward revealing and correcting miseducation, as well as renewing respectful relationships with Indigenous communities through our teaching, research, and community service.
Thank you, Shanique. And now we have an introductory welcome to Black History Month by Dr. Opio Oloya, Associate Vice President of the Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion.
Thank you, Leslie. Good afternoon and happy New Year, Chinese New Year, and welcome to Western Inaugural Black History Month Speaker Series. My name, of course, is Opio Oloya, and I'm the Associate Vice President for Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to the first of a series of great speakers lined up for the celebration of this year's Black History Month at Western, something that we plan to do every year moving forward. Now, our speaker for today will be introduced momentarily, but I just wanted to make a quick remark. Up front, I want to thank the team here at the Office of EDI, Black Student Association, and Western Central Communications for working together to produce this series. Secondly, 96 years ago, in February 1926, an African-American historian came up with the idea of celebrating the accomplishment of African-Americans. Slowly, that idea expanded to a month-long celebration worldwide. This year, the official theme of Black History Month is February and Forever, celebrating Black history today and every day. Now, following that year, 1926, a year later, on October 10, 1927, here in London, Ontario, in the shadow of this great university at Old Town Hall, which is now converted into a music hall at the corner of Dundas Street and Rectory, an extraordinary event occurred, and it was all about Black excellence. The first convention of the Canadian League for the Advancement of Colored People was held here in town. And folks came from as far as Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania, New York City, Toronto, Chatham, Windsor, from everywhere. There was a lot of excitement. Now, the convention came up with three resolutions. And you have to remember, this is like 95 years ago. But those resolutions still resonate today as if they were freshly made. I'm just going to quickly read them. The first was that we do all within our power to banish petty prejudice, which bars success from ambitious and deserving colored youth. Now you can change the word colored with Black and you have it. The second resolution, that we prepare our boys and girls to fill all positions within the gift of our country. And the last one, that we seek with the assistance of fair-minded white citizens to find places for members of our race after they have prepared themselves. So you can replace fair-minded white citizen with allies today. And I think you still have very much a resolution that resonates with us to this day. So as we celebrate Black excellence this month at Western and across Canada, we must not take our eyes off the work that needs doing. As the ABP EDI at Western, I call on you, each of you, including our allies, to continue building space for Black voices and scholarship. Here at Western, there are a lot of initiatives that we are undertaking to support that. There is currently a process going on for hiring 5 new Black faculty professors. So that is undergoing. We are working with a proposal to create Black scholarship, admission scholarship. So that process is going to go forward and will go before the Senate subcommittee on February the 9th, next week. There are also discussions around the pathway for more Black students to enter professional programs, faculty of law, school of medicine, and so on. And that those discussions are ongoing. As well, there's a committee that is working on creating a major in Black studies. That committee's work is well underway. They're highly motivated, and they're looking to be able to have this program ready for the fall of 2023. So there's a lot of goodwill and a lot of motivation going here at Western. Together, we can achieve great things, and we'll have even more cause for celebration in a year's time. For today, many blessings to each of you and to our invited guest speaker. Welcome and thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Aloya. Now we welcome Lisette Ochoa, International Program Coordinator and Special Advisor to the President, Diversity and Inclusion with Brescia University College, to introduce our special guest speaker.
Thank you, Leslie. Christina Lord is a longtime member of the London Black community and has served in a volunteer capacity with several organizations over the years. She currently serves on the London Black History Coordinating Committee and the Congress of Black Women, London Chapter. Professionally, Christina has worked as an early childhood educator, professor, and with the international post-secondary students in a university environment. She's a Caribbean Canadian whose business Creating Change focuses on creating inclusive communities locally, nationally, and globally. Having committed 40 years of her professional and personal life to the betterment of others within Canada, USA, the Caribbean, and South America, Christina strives to promote global consciousness and unity. She holds a master's in adult education, community development, and is the recipient of several awards for her service in the community. She's known for having a beautiful heart, and in my eyes, is a true change maker. Please welcome Christina Lord.
Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you so much, Janique, for that land acknowledgement. And I'd like to express my appreciation for the opportunity that I have to reside here. And just a side note, it's wonderful to see Janique. She was a student when I was still at Brescia before I retired. And so it's great to have her here. Thank you, Lisette, for such kind words. I am humbled by this opportunity. It is wonderful to still feel as though I'm part of the Brescia family, despite having retired 2.5 years ago. Dr. Aloya, I thank you for sharing the reasons as to why we celebrate Black History Month. We have such a rich history. Black history is London's history, is Canada's history, is world history. And I really appreciate hearing the plans that you at Western here have for the going forward into the future. So I thank you for sharing that. And I also thank you and your team. And may I say how humbled I am and thankful to have been included in your inaugural Black History Month speaker series. Thank you all for joining us this afternoon for a brief look at how we arrived here. So a bit of transparency for everyone. I'm not a historian. I'm someone who is interested in people, community, and history, interested in learning from and hearing his stories, her stories, their stories, our stories. I'm just going to share my screen now. Oops, and I'm sorry. I need to. My apologies. I'm still learning this a year later after we've been Zooming. So my apologies, everyone. The stories which we may or may not have learned from over the years, but we can certainly now look at the reality of some of these and learn and relearn, potentially correcting some of these stories. I speak to you today as a Black cisgender woman, and I am aware of certain societal privileges that I have access to and strive to use this to contribute to the building up of our communities. I share as one who knows that I have so much still to learn and who is learning alongside many of you, not as one who is an expert on Blackness, Black history, or anything else Black for that matter. I am part of the diaspora and we are diverse in who we are and growing together. So everyone, how did the Black Canadian community get to Canada and London? I'd like to acknowledge those who paved the way for us to this point and trust that we can continue to forge the path and new ones going forward. The majority of Black Canadians are here because of the slave trade, which through the taking and enslavement of our African ancestors created the African diaspora. African people, mothers, fathers, children, healers, educators, aunties, were shackled and placed on slave ships. They disembarked in various places that were very strange to them as enslaved people. Enslavement took place as they were stripped of their families, communities, dignity, and the opportunity to be treated in a humane manner. Many of you may have seen photos like this before, which show the slave ship, and all of these little people are actually living people who were shoved onto the ships to be brought across the Atlantic to the Americas. The first shipload of Africans to reach British North America landed at Jamestown in 1619. So we believe that the first Black person in Canada was Matthew de Costa, who did not remain here. He did not reside here, but he had been hired by Europeans to act as a translator. So the first record that we have of an enslaved African was a young boy who was 6 years old. So at 6 years old, he was already enslaved and was sold several times with his final owner. And while he was still in servitude, he was baptized and given the name Olivier Lejeune. And he is what we consider our first known Black resident. And that was in 1628. So how did we get here from the continent of Africa, from the motherland? They had what they called the transatlantic slave trade. And it was a triangular trade in a sense, in that what happened was people from Africa would be picked up, would be put on those slave ships, and they would be carried across the Atlantic. They would be taken to South America, to various parts of South America, up through the Caribbean. They would be deposited in these various places and all the way up into the southern part of North America. And the primary Europeans that were bringing them were the British, the Portuguese, the French, the Spanish. And so throughout the years, many of these countries had different opportunities to conquer the various islands and countries while they were there. And so what they would do is they would deposit the enslaved people, collect their money for them, and they would also at the same time collect the goods and produce, things like coffee, cotton, sugar, which they would then put on these ships and take that back to Europe. And from there, they would go back to the African continent with various things to trade for the people that they were going to enslave. Things like guns, ammunition, alcohol, indigo-dyed Indian textiles, and other factory-made goods. And so this is how the triangle continued throughout the years. And you can see it shows us the number of slaves that were passed through this area and taken on. So the transatlantic slave trade can also be understood in terms of the sheer magnitude. So in 366 years, the European slavers loaded approximately 12.5 million Africans onto Atlantic slave ships. About 11 million survived the Middle Passage to landfall and life in the Americas. So it was a struggle getting there. And then of course, they're on in unknown land where they were separated, parents separated from their children, partners separated from each other, communities separated from each other so that they weren't able to communicate because they're coming from different parts of the continent. They had different languages that they spoke. They had different customs. And so that was all done in a way of being able to change that, change them all. Canada developed a reputation for being a safe haven. And this began during the American Revolution. And it continues today. There's still a lot of people who want to come to Canada because they believe that that they can have a better life here. And for some, that absolutely is so. So during the American Revolution, there was an estimated 100,000 Black people who fled to the British side from the Americans. And many of them actually fled their American masters in an attempt to secure a better life because they were promised that if they fought with the British and they won, that they would be given land and freedom. Unfortunately, that didn't necessarily happen. They were given land, and this happened in the East Coast, so Nova Scotia primarily. The land that they were given was not necessarily arable land, and so their struggles continued. So I'm going to go from the East Coast now, just over to the West Coast, and saying that in 1858 there were the first Black Californians who arrived in British Columbia. And so on the invitation of James Douglas, who was the governor of British Columbia at the time, the first ship carrying Black Californians landed in Victoria on the 26th of April, 1858. So here we have, you know, the folks from coming up from the States through on both sides of our country of Canada. Then we had another group of another set of mass migration that took place, and this happened roughly between 1850 to 1860, 1865. We had, 1815 to 1865. There was an estimated 30,000 to 40,000 freedom seekers who entered Canada, and they came up via what was called the Underground Railroad, which I'm guessing many of you have heard of. It wasn't a literal railroad. It was a way of conveying people up through the northern states into various parts of Canada. And the person that we know the best, who was considered the conductor of the Underground Railroad, would be Harriet Tubman. So many of them did come up through the Underground Railroad. Many also stole away and were able to get on their own. Many lost their lives on the way. There were lots of hardships, as you can imagine, with them coming up. And there were times where, if they were caught, they would be brutally punished, sometimes even killed. And along the way, they would sometimes, if there had been a slave that had been caught, the slave owners might actually hang that person or those people in trees lining the river, so that as a way of hopefully scaring any other runaways who wanted to try and leave and come to a better life. So the whole area around that we're looking at here in sort of southwestern Ontario became known as the main terminus of the Underground Railroad. And so newcomers migrated to various parts of what we now know as Ontario. And this included Niagara Falls, Buxton, Chatham, Owen Sound, Windsor, Sandwich, which is now a part of Windsor, Hamilton, Brantford, London, Oakville, and Toronto. And they also moved on to other parts of British North America, such as New Brunswick, Quebec, and Nova Scotia. After this mass migration, Black Canadians helped bring strong community, build strong communities, and contributed to the development of the provinces in which they lived and worked. And I would just like to encourage everyone, if you have not taken a day trip to any of these places that are close by to us, please, when the weather changes and gets a little brighter, when COVID lifts and perhaps there aren't as many restrictions, spend a day with your friends, your family, and drive south down towards Windsor, and just take the time to look at the history that is there. There are museums that still house a lot of the information. There are families that are descendants of the original folks who came up. And so much history. And I can say that for myself, coming from the Caribbean, and my mother, when she lived here, we loved spending our time, our summer times, traveling down and checking these places out. My mom particularly enjoyed North Buxton. And when she went there, she said, you know, I feel like I belong. And she loved going at any time, but she particularly liked going there during the Labor Day weekends, because at that time, it's absolutely incredible what takes place there. People from families from across North America and beyond, some of them who have moved further, come together. So they have these beautiful family reunions, and everybody is laughing and sharing their stories. And I remember we met a lady once when we were there, and she was in her 90s, and she was sharing with my mom. My mom was younger at the time, but she was sharing with my mom that she'd only missed coming to this family reunion once. And she was very, very ill. She was actually coming from California. And she said her family almost had to tie her down, because as sick as she was, she wanted to be able to come and relive the history and just hear more stories. And part of what happens at Buxton is that, and this is done, I know that some of the professors, history professors from Huron are very much involved with the study of the history. And so there's a conference that happens on the Friday where there's a sharing of new research, and they're always locating new families and new information. So it's very, very, very exciting. And so here we have these areas that were then folks moved into and set up communities and lived. And we certainly had our wonderful share of people who stopped and stayed in London. And so starting some of those families that reside still in London, because we still have many of the multi-generational families that live here. So, you know, we're talking about history, we're talking about his stories, her stories, their stories, and our stories. And I'd like to just at this point read a story, a very short one. And it is written by a person by the name of Alfred T. Jones. And he was a resident here in London. And it's taken from this book, The Narratives of Fugitive Slaves. I keep an apothecary on Rideout Street. I belonged in Madison County, Kentucky. I have made an arrangement with my master to purchase my freedom for $350. This was in 1833, when I was 23 years old. But before the business was completed, I learned that my master was negotiating with another party to sell me for $400. Upon this, I wrote for myself a pass. It was not spelled correctly, but nobody there supposed that a slave could write at all. I had to exhibit it but once on my way. I stopped a month at St. Catharines, then came to London, and have remained here ever since. The people from the old country, being many of them unaccustomed to colored people, have some strange ideas respecting us, a sort of secondhand prejudice, as Ward calls it. The majority of the people of color who come over here are not such as give a very good idea of what the people of color really are. They're not refined and educated. But as some years are passed since the colored men began to come in, there is an improvement perceptible. There are colored people employed in this city in almost all the mechanic arts, also in grocery and provision stores, etc. Many are succeeding well, are buying houses, speculating in lands, and some are living on the interest of their money. I expect to go to England shortly on a suit at law involving my title to a large property on Dundas Street, valued at $45,000. Not today. The case has been through Chancery in the provincial court, and I have now appealed to the House of Lords. I'm winding up my business preparatory to leaving. So just a snippet of someone's life here in London. This is to just give us a bit of an overview, a cursory glance of how many Black people were counted in the census over the years. And so we can see it started in 1901, and we can see that there are some years where there are more and some years where there are fewer people. And I still need to do some more research in terms of figuring out what happened in those timeframes that would mean that there were fewer people. I know sometimes it was because some may have gone back to live in the States if they had come from there with their families. They may have chosen to do that. Something else that's not here that happened in 1909, so sort of right in here, was the there were hundreds of Blacks who came up from Oklahoma and moved out to the prairies. So now we've got that sort of finishing off the what was the original lands at that time. And so we've now got Black communities across Canada. In 1961, this is 0.6% of the Canadian population were from other countries. And then that just includes all of Africa and not including South Africa. In 1966, there was the assisted passage loan scheme, which actually was something that assisted immigrants to get in to Canada. Originally, it was open to Europeans only, but then it was extended to people from the Caribbean as well. So you can see that the increase there as we go through. So between the 1800s and 1920s, there were several people from the West Indies, as it was called then, with the Caribbean now, who worked at some of the Cape coal mines in the East Coast, and so they moved from Jamaica to do that work. Many others also moved from Barbados to seek employment in similar coal mining stations. And after the 1920s, unfortunately, West Indians who sought for immigration could not do so since relocation nearly ended. So at one point, we weren't allowed to immigrate to Canada. But then that fortunately changed again. In 1948, the national decree demanded unskilled labor force. And so this took place sometime after the Second World War, and the law was passed to draw the attention of low-priced laborers from overseas states, again, encouraging and having people coming up from the Caribbean, many as well coming from Jamaica. So around 1955, there was what was called the West Indian Household Proposal. And what this was folks, particularly in the Toronto area, needing domestic staff, needing people to work in their homes, to take care of their homes, to take care of their children. And so a new act was passed through immigration that would allow for single women who were between the ages of 18 and 36. And they were invited to come, and most of them came up through from Jamaica and Barbados, because those were the two places that were designated to bring them from. And what this meant was that some women would lie. They might not be single, They might be married, they might have children, but this was such a wonderful opportunity to come to Canada, they felt, to make money that they could then send back home. And so many of them came, did the work, were not able to go home because any money that they collected, that they made, they felt it was better to send that money home to take care of their children and their families rather than to use the money to travel home themselves. And so what we ended up having was several families in Jamaica, in Barbados and some of the other islands who were being raised by aunties, you know, grandparents, and never really knowing who their mother was because she was up here. A lot of the women when they were here then became educated, became a lot of our first Black from the Caribbean teachers and nurses. And so later on in the 1970s and 80s, things were changed where they were now allowed to bring their families up. And I remember I lived in Toronto at the time in the 80s. And, you know, we had several meetings where there was some real concern about the challenges that these children, these families were experiencing because the children had been taken away from their caregivers, their grandparents or aunties, whoever had been raising them for how many years, the village that they had grown up with, the village of people who were taking care of them. They were brought here to primarily the Toronto area, the GTA. And now they're living with someone that they didn't know very well. Everyone was trying their best, but there's, if you know anything about loss, there's always so many feelings that are associated with that. And they're also in a different country. They're going to schools that have a different system. They're going to schools that aren't understanding. And so I remember, you know, there were many meetings with the education system at that time, trying to figure out, you know, how can we best help these families and not just sort of make assumptions and push these children aside. So lots of hardship that is endured over time, for sure. And so a little bit more recently, we're coming to where this is where the place of birth of many of the more recent Black immigrants. So where are they coming from? And so we can see that probably almost an equal amount coming out of the continent of Africa and coming up from the Caribbean and Bermuda. And so that's where a lot of that was happening. Long established Black immigrants were mostly from the Caribbean, but recent immigrants were predominantly from Africa. And according to the 2016 census, more than half, so 56.7% of the Black immigrants who landed before 1981 were born in either Jamaica or Haiti. Black newcomers now come from about 125 different countries. The top countries of birth for Black immigrants admitted between 2011 and 2016 were Haiti, Nigeria, Cameroon, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. So we're gradually all moving in together from the and creating a bigger diaspora. So this just shows us a bit about the distribution of Black immigrants over the years. And we can see the one economic immigrants, so the ones who came in on their own recognizance due to economic reasons and were able to find jobs to bring money into the country. Immigrants who were sponsored by family, and I'll share a little bit later, but certainly my family fits into that category there. We also have refugees who Canada has started to, in the early 1980s, started to accept more and more refugees, and so coming from countries that really needed to be able to be here. So in the late 1960s, Canada's immigration policy changed significantly, and they removed a lot of what was considered discriminatory in their policies at the time based on race or national origins. And so that's when they came up with the point system, and that speaks to this group of people who were able to join. Among those who still lived in Canada in 2016, the majority of the Black immigrants who landed in the 80s and 90s were sponsored by their family already living in the country. And I know coming up from the Caribbean, Many families, there was a grand exodus, the end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s, and then they in turn brought family up with them. The largest share, 40.3% of Black newcomers from 2011 to 2016 were admitted under the new economic program, and about 3 in 10 Black newcomers were refugees. So the top countries of birth of economic newcomers were Nigeria, Haiti, so that's these folks, Nigeria, Haiti, Cameroon, Cote d'Ivoire, and Jamaica. And the top countries for the, the top country for the birth of new refugees was the Democratic Republic of Congo, Eritrea, Haiti, Somalia, and Ethiopia. About 44,285 Black people were non-permanent residents in Canada in 2016. And they were living temporarily in Canada on a work or study permit, raise my hand on that one, or as refugee claimants. So many different status, immigration status that have us here. And then this is just to show us the period of immigration for Black immigrants to Canada. So we can see prior to 1981, and then, so between 2001, 2010 was when we had the biggest spike. And I think that would relate to the incoming of refugees. So why are we here? Well, that's a really good question. And certainly we're here for many reasons. Some of the reasons that that I came up with were Canada is considered a safe country. It is one of the top countries for accepting refugees for a recognition of safety in those refugees coming into Canada. So, and certainly here in London, we've had, I don't know how many, but I know that we have a consistent flow of refugees from various countries over the years. We have various settlement agencies that are here and have evolved over the years as we learn more and more about the needs of refugees, and that there's not just a set of needs for refugees. There's a needs for each person, each group coming from different places. So there's a lot of learning that's gone on over the years to be able to be a lot more welcoming to these various folks when they land in Canada and in London. And certainly lots of community-minded and community members and church groups, faith groups, who are willing to assist with settlement of these folks when they come into the country. So, and it is, I mean, Canada is primarily a safe country to live in. We have some challenges, of course, but by and large, it is a safe place to be. Family, many folks come because of family. They already have family here. So this is why my parents ended up coming here as well, was because we were here, and so they came and joined. But also they come because they think it's a better place to raise a family for folks who haven't started a family yet. And so they see a lot of potential for having families, a lot of a place to raise their children. Education. Canada has a very high reputation for education, looking at higher ed as well, the various colleges and universities. Certainly here in London, I know that from working at Brescia with the international students, that Western does have a good reputation. There are many students who want to come, and many of them that I met over the years, particularly from the Caribbean, wanted to come here because their parents had studied here, or their uncles had studied here, their aunts had studied here. So there's that connection that perhaps started back in the 70s or earlier for some families that continues throughout the years. And so things like what Western is doing right now, what I know Huron and Brescia and King's are also doing in terms of really taking a different look at the students and the students' needs. And in this case, as we're talking today, in terms of the Black students is some of the plans that were shared earlier. This is just going to encourage more students to want to come to London. and leaves us having to create those safer spaces for them to come. Mentioned earlier too, you know, people are looking at a better life. There's a sense sometimes here that we have a more balanced playing field. When we look at the hierarchy of our class structure, it's not as divided perhaps as it is in some countries. And so someone could come, you know, to Canada and do jobs working in a factory, for example, and be accepted by everyone around. Whereas perhaps if they were doing that kind of a job in their home country, the acceptance wouldn't necessarily be there. So there's that opportunity. Employment. There is ample employment for folks. Unfortunately, some of the people who come in from other countries who have are differently educated because they don't have the Canadian requirements or the Canadian credentials are challenged with finding employment. And again, something that is being worked on that needs more work, but there is essentially employment here for people. Another reason too, in terms of, so these are all sort of why Canada, why London, and something more specific to London, besides it being such a beautiful space with so much green space, the rivers, it's also on the 401 corridor. So it allows easy access to Michigan, to Toronto, to Montreal. So if you're flying, you've got easy access to airports. And if you're traveling, you know, by car, then you've got the 401. So if you want to go to Toronto, you can go to Toronto in a day, you know, go to the various ethnocultural parts of Toronto, if that's what you're looking for, whatever it is that you want. So it's easy access for that. So when I was thinking about this, one of the things I was thinking about is that, you know, Canada is sometimes seen as a land of milk and honey. A beacon of hope, an educational opportunity. It's a place that many people have chosen. And is it really a land of milk and honey? Something for us to think about it. And if it isn't, what do we need to do to create it so that it's more like that? And so those of us coming from the African diaspora have very diverse lived experiences. Despite the fact that we may identify as Black, that might be in some cases one of the only threads that holds some of us together. So we need to be aware of the fact that within that Blackness, there is a huge, huge diversity and get to know what that's all about. We have different societal privileges. Adapting and adjusting to life in Canada certainly looks different for all of us. So why London? And when I say why London, I'm going to get a little bit more personal and a bit specific to myself as to why I ended up or how I ended up here in London. So I think I may have mentioned it or alluded to it. I'm from the Caribbean. I was born in Guyana. I grew up in Jamaica and some parts of many years in the Cayman Islands as well. And so all I knew growing up was the Caribbean and what we, you know, people that we may have met from other parts of the world, the news, various ways, a lot of the history that we learned, which we're now having to relearn. So I don't remember as a teenager having a conversation about if I would go overseas for my post-secondary education. I just knew that at some point there was a decision made that I would be coming to Ontario. And I say Ontario because it really didn't mean that much to us, other than we had family in the Toronto area. So without the amazing resources that are now available to international students, we figured it out somehow. And I landed in Sarnia to attend Lambton College with great appreciation to my faith community who took me in and provided a home and friendship without ever meeting me. And they just welcomed me into their homes. It is here that I learned that it wasn't enough to be Caribbean or Jamaican, or even Guyanese. But was I Black or white? The folks who were always asking me were white. So I figured I probably couldn't be white, because if I was, then they wouldn't have to ask that question. So therefore, I guess I would identify as Black, which wasn't a difficulty for me to do. And so that was when I started with that identity, that expression, that feeling of settling into my Blackness here in North America. And I stayed in Canada. That was not my intention. When I left the Caribbean, it was with the intention to study and to return home to serve and work alongside those building whatever country or island I ended up back in. Well, you know what they say about the best laid plans. They don't always work out that way. So here it was. I settled in to live here and adjusted as best I could. Still adjusting to the weather, I have to say. I don't think I'll ever really be accustomed to the winter weather. I met someone, got married, had two beautiful children, had jobs as an early childhood educator, which is what I had studied when I was at Lambton, and became a permanent resident and then a citizen. And I immersed myself in whatever life was going to offer me here in Canada. My family had moved to England a few years after I left Jamaica. And so now that I had children and my parents had grandchildren, there was a decision to be made. My mom pined after the grandchildren. And so at one point we decided that perhaps they would come and live here. So my parents and my sister were able to move here. And we were very blessed that things worked out through immigration, with employment, and they were able to join us here in Canada. Adulting in Canada was a whole new path for me, and learning to navigate the pitfalls was a challenge. But with the ongoing support of family and friends, and I did make some very strong and supportive friends, some of whom I'm still very good friends with today. So it's wonderful to have those strong connections. And there was so much to enjoy here in Canada, in Ontario, and you know, in traveling and seeing and meeting people and just knowing what could happen. So why London? You know, obviously I was in Sarnia, then we moved to Toronto, moved around a little bit. London had a job. And so it was a job, an opportunity to truly settle and raise my children. I still succumbed to some of my nomadic nature over the years, despite that. Upon reflection, though, I'm appreciative of those who invited me into their spaces, and particularly those who invited me into their spaces as a volunteer. Volunteering with like-minded folks looking to build capacity, though that's not what we called it back then, raise awareness about multiculturalism and unity. I have to say, it sometimes saddens me that the terminology has had many iterations, but the work still feels the same at times. And when we think about some of the challenges over the last 2 years, I know many of us in the community, in the Black community, are exhausted. And we're also hopeful, because some of the work, some of the recognition by others means that we're moving forward. London's diversity has increased in so many ways over the years. So I moved to London in the late 80s. So I've been here that long. And London's diversity has increased in so many ways. I truly believe that as we truly acknowledge our differences and learn and relearn our histories and share our stories and lived experiences, that we can move forward together. This can look like all the feelings of love, compassion, anger, frustration, empathy, and sometimes all those feelings at the same time. But we're in this together, so let's do it together. We have the resources, we have the facilities, we have the capacity. We're building more capacity, we're increasing our capacity. I stay in London because I've planted my roots here. I feel I can make a difference, and I get to watch two of my three grandbabies grow up. These three little ones inspire me daily to keep the work going so that they have a different future to look forward to. And that's, you know, our way was paved for us, and it's our role to pave the way for those who are coming after us. Every experience that I've had throughout my life has brought me to where I am today. And regrets? Well, I suppose I could say I have a few, but nothing that would change, that I would change in my life. So that is why I continue to stay in London and be involved with the various community organizations, the work that I do. London for me has now become home. I used to say Sarnia was my Canadian home, and it is in terms of where I first came to, but London is where my roots are right now. And so I'd like to share with you some tangible examples of Londoners coming together to build the community. I am part of the, as was mentioned earlier, the London Black History Coordinating Committee, which was established in 2002. And just to share some photos with you, we have, this was a 10th anniversary celebration that we held. And I must say that we've had amazing partners throughout the years. So the Museum London always hosts us for the opening. The library has been instrumental in giving us space for the closing gala, and more recently more involved in the children's and family programming. Prior to that, we would do that at the Children's Museum, and there is Bill Paul, may he rest in peace, a bridge builder himself. And Bill was always there to make the balloon animals for the children. A lovely London family, Carl Loco from Ghana, his spouse Heather and their children, who would always come to the pub, to the museum, and more recently on Zoom, as we've had to do it in the last year or so, and entertain us with their music. But also Carl is a great storyteller. And so he would tell us some really great stories from Ghana that he'd learned growing up, with a lot of lessons threaded into his stories. This is Rosemary Sadlier, who was our keynote speaker at our 10th year anniversary. Two of our hardworking, dedicated committee members, Leroy and Silence, who I'm sure you know, many of you know. And so this year we are celebrating our 20th anniversary, and very, very excited, about it. The goal of the London Black History Coordinating Committee is to engage the community in celebrating Black History Month through organizing, supporting, and collaborating with community organizations on programs and activities that are available in the region to educate, inform, and uplift. And so again, it's about bringing us all together. It's about learning together. And I encourage you, if you haven't already heard of how to get involved and join our virtual activities again this year, which hopefully next year will be in person, I encourage you to go to the website, which is lbhcc.ca. So lbhcc.ca. And there you will find not just the events that are planned by our committee, but also events that are being hosted by other groups in town. Something else that's going on, this is a clip from 1926, and it was then a landmark of London, and it continues to be, and we're going to, you know, there's work afoot to revitalize that. So the Fugitive Slave Chapel of London, which was located on Thames Street, was given to Londoners, I've lost the year, several years ago, and it sat for a long time on the grounds of Beth Emmanuel Church, and the Fanshawe Pioneer Village has been offered the opportunity to take this building, to have it settled in the Pioneer Village area, and to be able to utilize it in a way that they utilize their other spaces, in a way of helping Londoners and tourists and visitors to learn more about the Black history of London. And so this is ongoing, you know, keep your ears open. There's definitely more to be heard about it, but what an historic occasion that we will be able to go into this space. We'll be able to see this space. And somebody asked me the other day, and I'm not sure if this will happen, but somebody said, hey, can we actually have weddings in there? Like, wouldn't that be really cool? So we'll have to see what happens there, but I share that with you as a collaborative initiative that is ongoing here in London. there are many things that are being partnered and collaborated with. And it's, for me, it's just exciting and just forward moving. Another thing I'd like to mention is the Black Community Library. And yay, this library opened yesterday. It is, as I say here, it's a collaboration of services with WEAN, which is a community center, the London Public Library, and their teams and volunteers. And so what this is an opportunity for, it's a space that will house books that are authored by Black authors, particularly Black Canadian authors, also Indigenous authors as well will be housed there. Books about the Black community, opportunities for us to go and see ourselves reflected. The London Public Library does an amazing job with the books that they do have. This gives another opportunity for us to access more specific books. And because of the connection with the London Public Library, if you go into the London Public Library and you're looking for a book that they don't have, but they know it's at the Black Community Library, they'll direct you to the Black Community Library. So it's a beautiful small space. It's got tables where, when we're no longer living under COVID protocols, people can come together. When I was in the space yesterday, which was my first time there, I could actually envision people sitting around these tables, maybe on some of the extra chairs, learning from each other, sharing things that are in the books. My grandchildren, when they heard about it, said, well, is it only Black people who can go there? Because, you know, there are a lot of other people that need to learn about what Black people know as well. So out of the mouths of babes, you know, one of the folks who was there yesterday was saying that her granddaughter was shocked when she saw all of these books, and she saw on the front cover of one of the books, she saw a Black woman. And she said, I didn't think that we could be on the cover of books. So there is so much, there is so much that we have to learn and that we are learning. And so I encourage you to, you know, again, go online, check out the WEAN Community Center. And when things are open at this point, you just have to call to get a book, and then they'll make an appointment for you to come in. But when things are open, go and browse. They're also open to donations of books. So if you have books by Black authors that are maybe sitting on a shelf that you bought and didn't get around to it, and they're gently used, please get in touch with Pastor Sandy Thomas, and they would love to be able to have them. So this is a place where there's representation, where we can see ourselves. One of the things that we need more of in London is that ability to see ourselves. One of the things that Western will have in the new, in the hiring of new faculty. So we're on board. We're moving forward. We're moving forward. At this time, I would like to express my deep appreciation to the Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion here at Western and the partners that you have had in setting this up, for stepping up and showing the importance of showcasing Black excellence in history. I know that you will keep the momentum going. I'd also like to thank you all for your time today. It warms my heart to have friends from various countries joining and supporting me, and for others of you whom I haven't met yet, but who knows, London is not that big a place, we may meet. I hope you all received a small nugget that you could take away and ponder on. And I hope that you stay safe and have a happy Black History Month. I look forward to seeing some of you online. To close, I'm going to play a video, and it's a video, it's called Hymn to Freedom. It's from the Hymn to Freedom Project. And this will give you just a bit of a look at some of the Black Canadians throughout the years. And for those that you are new to you, then something for you to look at further. Otherwise, I invite you to sit back, enjoy the video, and there will be an opportunity for Q&A following. Thank you so much, everybody. I really appreciate your time. Take good care.
Thank you. when we'll be free. When every heart joins every heart together, mold our destiny. That's when
join in our song.